Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear.
Those that are tired of this book, I'm not tired of it. I mean, there's plenty of stuff to preach from out of this book.
And also, it's your name too, as well.
That's right. You're short. You'll notice that it's 2 Timothy and not 2 Turtle. It is the fourth chapter, so it is the last chapter of this letter. And this is what the Apostle Paul says in the fourth chapter, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. So he recognizes that he is stating this as a representative for God, and that they are watching, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus. Who will do what?
Judge.
The living and the dead. Now, some people may have questions about that. Look with me at John chapter 5. We'll come back to this. John chapter 5. John chapter 5, verse 22. By the way, for those of you that have red letter editions of the Bible, what color are these words?
Red.
Which means what?
It's Jesus that's speaking.
All right. And the 22nd verse is in red, so this is Jesus saying this. What does he say in verse 22? Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all
judgment to the Son.
To the Son.
Which is Jesus.
Absolutely. So the Apostle Paul starts this last chapter of 2 Timothy, very first verse. He says, I'm telling you, Timothy, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge, as he says here in this the fourth chapter, who will judge the living and the dead? And we've just read this passage of Scripture where Jesus said, yeah, the Father has entrusted all judgment to me. And so, let me just expound on this a little bit more. When Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life, what's the second part of that verse? No one comes to the Father.
Except through me.
So you got to come past Jesus. All judgment is to Jesus. And again, as I've said before, other religions, they would almost see that as blasphemous. God's not going to allow anybody to, you know, override him. But I don't look at it as being overriding. It's just that God has said, son, this is what you're going to do. Everybody that has acknowledged you, you know, you have the ability to forgive them and give to them the gift of eternal life. Everybody that has rejected you, they're not going to even see me. Jesus said again in John chapter 5, verse 22, all judgment has been entrusted to the Son. So Paul is saying to Timothy, I'm telling you this, it's not just this fourth chapter, but all of this letter, I'm telling you, Timothy, in the presence of God and of Jesus Christ, who's going to judge everybody. He's going to judge the living and the dead. What does he say? And in view of, back to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1, and in view of his appearing, Jesus said, I will come again. He said, when I come again, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess, but every eye shall see him. There won't be a place on the face of this planet that isn't going to see Jesus. He told the disciples as he was going back to heaven. The angels came and they said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand there looking up into heaven? The same Jesus who took it from you is going to come again. And this next time when he comes, he's not coming to save the world. He's coming to judge the world and to rule. And to rule and do what? Set up his kingdom. So, in view of his appearing and his kingdom, Pilate, when Jesus was before him, said, "Are you a king?" And Jesus says, "Yeah, but my kingdom
is not
of this world." I know there's a lot of discussion about the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. For those that aren't aware, in the book of Revelation, it does talk about a 1,000-year time period in which Jesus will set up his kingdom. A lot of people believe that it's going to be here on earth. And then after the end of the 1,000 years, it's going to let Satan loose. And Satan's going to come out to deceive and to cause all sorts of havoc on the earth, and then the end will come. Well, only, whether you believe, because there's some that end up believing the reference out of the book of Revelation is more of a symbolic statement. It's not a literal one. But whether you believe in that literal millennial reign of Jesus Christ, or if you believe it is kind of figurative, it's kind of symbolic, there is coming a day that Jesus Christ will rule and reign over everything. And for those that want to deny Jesus Christ, they're going to have to stand before him and say, "Yeah, I didn't think that you could do that." And Jesus is going to say, "Yeah, all power, I told you, all authority." That's what he said in Matthew chapter 28, before he spoke the Great Commission. "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, and teach them to observe everything I've commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world." So Jesus is coming again. He's going to appear. He's going to set up his kingdom. Whether or not it's a 1,000-year literal reign here on earth, the Bible also speaks in the book of Revelation that there will be a new heaven
and a new earth.
And a new earth. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. So he says, in light of this, I'm giving you this charge. I'm giving you this order. This is what I want you to do. Now we can interpret this next verse of scripture as Paul just telling Timothy, this is what I want you to do. Or we can personalize it. Let me just ask before you personalize it, do you think that it's right? Or do you think it's wrong to take it as a message for you and for me as well? Some might say, no, this was just a message for Timothy. Don't ask all of us to do that, because Paul wasn't asking everybody to do that. Let me follow that up with another question. Do you think that Paul would be opposed to everybody else doing it? I don't think that he would. I think the Apostle Paul would say everybody that calls themselves a Christian, everybody that has followed Jesus Christ, has a responsibility to serve the King. Don't just place the task of preaching the word, because that's what the next verse is going to say. Do not just make that the task of preachers. I believe that it's something that all of us have been instructed to do. So what does he say that all of us should be doing there in the second verse? I've already mentioned it. What does he say in the second verse? This is what he wants Timothy to do, and I believe it's what he wants all of us to do. Preach the word. Now, there are two possible explanations of the words, the word, that we could use. One could be, preach the word, meaning Jesus Christ. If you go back to John chapter 1, John the Apostle writes in John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. So you could make the argument when Paul is saying preach the Word, you could say he's trying to tell us what we really need to be doing is preaching Jesus. What the world needs now is not love, sweet love. What the world needs now is Jesus. Jesus. make sure that you preach accurately who Jesus is. Has Jesus been misrepresented? Are there those out there that are misrepresenting Jesus? And if so, how are they misrepresenting Jesus? Can you name any people that are misrepresenting Jesus?
That cult group.
What's that?
Texas, that cult leader from Waco, Texas.
Cult leader from Waco, Texas? Okay. Because there are some out there that call themselves Christians. In fact, I know that one of the most offensive groups in America in recent years was a Baptist group. They called themselves Baptist, but they would show up at sites where they were bringing back fallen soldiers, and they were screaming all sorts of hate messages that all these people deserved it and all these people were going to burn in hell. I'm talking about the soldiers, and they called themselves Christians. So there are people like that, cults, that are misrepresenting Jesus. Are there personalities? I'm talking about celebrities, athletes, that misrepresent who Jesus is. I'm saying this not to necessarily give them a black eye, but I'm just telling you, it is commonplace. You know, I've had people say, you need to get over Pastor Tim, but they say that he might be the greatest three-point shooter in NBA history.
Stephen Curry
professes himself to be a Christian, and from what I understand, I was told that he has put on his tennis shoes, Philippians 4:13, I can do all things in Christ who strengthens me. But he's out there not only actively supporting Joe Biden and the policies, but he's fully in favor of abortion, fully in favor of transgenders, fully in favor of homosexual and lesbians getting married. Calls himself a Christian. I got news for you. You support that stuff, you are not following Christ's Bible. And there are people out there misrepresenting Jesus Christ. All that they want to preach out is how Jesus saves everybody. And they don't want to look at the righteousness and the holiness that Jesus preached. Jesus, when he went out to preach, he was going out to tell people, repent and be saved. There needs to be a turning away. And if you don't turn away from those things that are offensive to God, you're going to suffer the consequences of your rebellious activity. So I just, I'm not saying that to pick on him, because there's a lot of people out there that are doing this. All that they want to talk about is just the grace of Jesus Christ. This amazing grace. Let me tell you what, God did come to save sinners. Jesus did come to save sinners. But he tells people, you need to repent first. You need to repent and be saved. Don't think that God's just going to save you because you're going to keep doing the same old thing. There needs to be repentance. So preach Jesus. That could be one interpretation of where he says preach the word. What would be the other interpretation of preach the word? Miss Bessie holds up her Bible. Preach the Bible. That's the word. God has given us a glimpse. What the Bible really is, it gives us a glimpse into who God is, what God approves of, what God disapproves of. Some people might come along and say, well, you think that that's true. All I can say is that you start violating the principles of this, you're going to see it ain't going to work. Not only is it not going to work, it's going to bring down judgment upon your land. I know that the church many times has been criticized because we preach so much against, you know, the LGBTQ stuff. But you got to look back at Sodom and Gomorrah, that when these nations, these two cities, when they dared to disobey God, God wiped them out. A lot of people fail to recognize that before the children of Israel entered the promised land, if you go back and read Leviticus chapter 18, where God speaks against all sorts of illicit sexual behavior. It says in that chapter, if I'm not mistaken, there toward the end of it, that the people of the land that were in that, where the Israelites were going into, the people of the land practice all of these evil things. They practice bestiality. They practice homosexuality. They practice incest. And God says, because of this, my judgment is upon them. I'm going to wipe them out. I'm going to eradicate them. The land itself is going to vomit them out. So I'm just trying to make the point. People sometimes think today, well, this is the first time that this sort of stuff, this sort of teaching that we're being bombarded by, they think that this is the first time in human history that it's ever been tried. And I'm here to tell you, no, it's not. And every time that people go down this path, it leads to utter destruction. Say the same thing about socialism. Socialism good? And I can't get responses out of y'all at all tonight. What is socialism? Rather than for you working to get what you, the harder you work, the more you earn. Socialism teaches that you just work and you live off what everybody else does. If you decide not to, then you're going to sponge off the guy that is working. I watched a video the other day that came through on my phone that somebody was trying to explain what socialism was, and they used an experiment in classroom to show. The teacher at the beginning of the year stood in front of the class and said, just want everybody to know, everybody seems to be liking socialism. Socialism means that everybody gets the same thing. That's why I told you that my cousin who married a girl from Venezuela.
Yeah.
Venezuela, that's what they became, is a socialist country, and it's absolutely, people have left the country by the millions. Why did they leave? Because she said, the person that picks up the garbage makes as much money as the doctor. Socialism means that you just take everybody's money, put it in a common pot, and then you dispense it out so that everybody gets the same amount. So this video that I watched talked about this teacher that walked in, and because the students all said that they liked the idea of socialism, because they really targeted the younger generation these days. The teacher said, I just want to let everybody know, everybody's going to get the same grade. So when it came time for the first test, there were those that had been raised, you know, if you want to get a good grade, you better study hard. So they studied hard in order not to get a failing grade. Then there were others that said, no need to study because we're all going to get the same grade. So the grades came back and everybody got like Bs. The kids that had to study hard, they looked over the kid next to them. Why in the world did you get a D? You didn't study. Well, that's the way socialism goes. So as the semester went on, the kids that had been studying said, why do we even want to study? Everybody's going to get the same grade. So nobody studied. In the end, everybody flunked out. Most people are unaware that when our country was founded, and the pilgrims got off the Mayflower and they began to set up camp here in the United States. Some of the people that had been over in England had kind of life kind of easy, and they were accustomed to other people doing the work. And over here, there wasn't anybody to do extra work. So there were only a few people that were out there planting the gardens and working and whatnot. And at the end of the first year, because these others that weren't accustomed to work, and they just came and took from out of the common pile. People about starved to death because they had too many freeloaders. And William Bradford said, hey, look, some things are going to change here within this community. Said this next year, we've got a new law that we're enacting. You don't work, you don't eat. You're going to get to eat whatever you grow. And said that it changed the entire environment of the people over here. I've told you before, maybe the only quote that I remember from Margaret Thatcher. People tell me that she made. Margaret Thatcher was Prime Minister of Great Britain for quite some time. She had made the comment. She said, the problem with socialism is that sooner or later you run out of everybody else's money. We we've built our nation on capitalism. It means that if you want to work hard and earn, you're going to get rewarded for it. You want to sit at home and do nothing, you're going to suffer the consequences for it. It's one of the things that we've been objecting to within this country, is that we've become a country of just handing out to people that want to be freeloaders. It's destroying our country. So you end up saying, well, how do we get off on this topic? The Apostle Paul is saying, preach Jesus, but also preach what the Word of God teaches. What does the Word of God say about work? You don't work?
You don't eat.
Don't eat. You made the decision. Don't sit around and blame somebody else. Now, I think that everybody within the Christian community, even the Bible itself, says that if there are needy people around you, help the needy people. The problem in America isn't that people are so much needy, is that they are lazy. They don't want to work. You can't even get people nowadays, and this isn't you, Turtle, because I know that you're frantically trying to get a job. You can't get people today to work for $10, $11, $12, $13,
$14, $15, $16 an hour. Some of them won't get out of bed for no less than 25. I'm like, excuse me, I can remember when I started working. Started out 50 cents an hour washing dishes.
I was going to say, how much did the rest of y'all make when you first started out?
I made a penny.
A penny.
And there you go.
A penny a brick.
Each brick I cleaned.
Well, you got rich at that job. What'd you do with all your money? How about other stories?
Her mother was one of the hardest working people I ever saw. And I didn't know her that many years. But she never sat down very much.
If you want something, you better work for it. It's not going to be given to you. You started to say no.
I worked at Cream King in Wellsburg.
Do you remember what you made?
It wasn't very much.
I think when I was in high school working at the auto parts warehouse, I think I was making like $2.35 an hour.
I was going to say, I thought it was about $1.75 or something. That's stacking.
Well, I remember one time pulling weeds for my uncle down in the soybean fields, pulling coffee weeds, and he paid us $1 an hour.
But I worked for Patsy Cipollotti Sr., and he paid the girls well because he expected good work, and the better you worked, the better you were paid. Mm-hmm. And
that's,
you know,
promise.
He had girls for the work 4 or 5 years, huh? So he called me after we were married. He lost a couple girls, and I went back and worked for him back then. You know,
okay.
So.
Well, we can all remember when times, you know, my dad isn't here, but he still remembers working at mowing the cemetery over there in West Alexander, 50 cents an hour. He said at the end of a work week, 40-hour work week, he'd be given a $20 bill. Yeah. Back then, they just had the old reel push mowers. It wasn't anything with a gas engine on it. Those reel mowers were reel mowers.
Yeah, they were.
A lot of hard work if you've ever tried one, you owe it to yourself. And then, of course, when you had to trim around all of the headstones in the cemetery, there weren't any weed eaters. I remember when those things came out in the early to mid-1970s. The first time that I saw one on a video was in Pensacola, Florida at the Raleigh Bicycle Shop, and it showed that, and it was kind of like, wow, I don't know why it was out of the bicycle shop. At least that's what my memory is. And but back then, you just had the little hand clippers.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. They weren't battery operated, buddy.
No, your hands.
You got down, you had to bend over, and you had to go. If you can imagine, go through a cemetery with all of the headstones and in the hot summer sun. And
you know what you used to get with those? Blisters.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I know that some people are saying, why did we get off on this discussion? Because Paul is saying to Timothy, you need to not only preach Jesus, you need to preach what the Word of God teaches. And we've got a generation today. Am I being too hard on the younger generation today? Or is there really, on their part, a feeling of entitlement that the world owes them something?
It is, but it's not just the younger generation. I know people older than me that don't want to do nothing at work.
Hey, April, you're no longer the younger generation. You're right. It is older ones. But I'm just saying, the kids of today, and I'll just bring this up for the older generation. When we were growing up, Cheryl, we didn't have all this.
Yep.
Where would we be?
I'd be out on a basketball court somewhere, or a baseball field.
Or a bicycle.
Or on a bicycle.
Bicycles. We rode bicycles everywhere.
And today, you look around the neighborhoods, and you see what? Empty playgrounds.
Playing with those little green men.
Little green army men?
Yeah, those little green army men and Indians. Yeah, fort.
Yeah, I remember as a kid, not to chase a rabbit here.
Joe will tell you, when we grew up in Louise, they had a minors baseball league baseball team down there.
Okay.
And Patsy Pepe was the manager, and he would give us either 50 cents for chasing foul balls, one on each baseline, or a bottle knee high when the game was over.
You and Joe did that all the time.
Me and Joe.
And that was not 50 cents for each ball. It was for doing
the
whole game.
For the game.
Yeah.
They also would take shovels and shovel the snow off the basketball court so they could play basketball all
winter. Yeah, we'd shovel the court off to shoot a ball around.
Yeah. Robin, back to your story about the little green men, I don't mean to chase a rabbit. What we did down in Alabama, because fireworks were legal, we would build little forts and whatnot and put the army men in there and then take the fireworks and blow them up. Paul said to Timothy, there's a need for you to preach the word. And here again, this is where we've got to personalize it, because the Apostle Paul is saying to Timothy, do that. But he's saying to every Christian, you need
we
to make
need
sure
to
in your home, with your kids and your grandkids and your great-grandkids, you need to tell them what the Word of God says. And we're growing up in a society today that is totally ignorant of the Word of God. I may share this again one of these days later. Let me pull this up right quick. This is from Christianity Today, which I've got some issues with, but anyway. A report says that 26 million Americans stopped reading the Bible regularly during COVID-19.
During what?
During COVID-19, they stopped reading the Bible.
They needed it more than
they did.
That's when they needed it.
It said, and this was within the first year, the data said roughly 26 million people had mostly or completely stopped reading the Bible in the last year. Here's another one. This is not talking about the United States. This is talking over in Germany. It said a new study from the theologians at the University of Leipzig finds that only, again, this is Germany, finds that only 1.6% of the German population reads the Bible at least once a day. 1.6%. And only 3.2% read it every week. So let me just ask you, how much of an impact is the Bible having on the people of Germany? If you don't read it, you don't know what it says. If you don't know what it says, you're not going to do what it's saying, because you don't know what it says. And I fear that one of the big things that's going on within America these days, there isn't a reading of the Word of God. And some people, faithfully every day, that newspaper comes in, they will read it from cover to cover, every single article. Not that there's a lot in newspapers anymore. But do we give the same sort of attention to what the Word of God says? If you're going to preach the word, you better know what the word says. Make it your goal. I need to start reading the Bible.
I'm guilty of not reading Lamentations. I never did more than went past it. But since we've been studying at night here, I'm glad.
Yeah. And there's a tendency on all of our parts, Chuck, to focus on certain passages of Scripture, certain books of the Bible, certain chapters, certain verses. And we have a tendency to just disregard some of them because we don't see any relevance. We don't see any importance. And so we just kind of write it off. Almost like what we studied in Sunday school class this morning with King Jehoiakim when he was given copies of the scroll. And he didn't like what it said, and so he would just chop off bits of it and throw it over there in the fire and said, to say it doesn't matter. And I'm going to tell you, the Word of God is telling us, it gives us a glimpse into what God is like. And God is trying to tell us, this is the way I want you to function. This is the way I want you to perform. So I know that I need to draw this to a close. Paul said to Timothy, I'm telling you right now, if you want to know what I want you to do, this is what I want you to do. I want you to preach the word, which means preach Jesus, or it could mean preach what the Bible says.
Or both.
And he finishes that thought up with this, preach the word. Be prepared to do it in season and out of season. Be ready at any time to share with people why you live the way that you live, why you believe the way that you believe, why you act the way that you act. Be prepared to tell them. It is because of Jesus. It is because of the Word of God. And it said, and I'll just quickly add this, correct, rebuke, and encourage. It's not the entire rest of the sentence because it says, do it with great patience and careful instruction. We'll maybe get a chance to look at that again next week. But there is a need for us, yes, to preach Jesus Christ. Be careful of Jesus that you're preaching. Because Jesus didn't come to condone sin. He came to tell us, I want you to turn away from sin. Preach Jesus, but also preach what the Word of God says. Somebody said it. I don't know that I can quote it accurately. I'll do my best. Preach Jesus everywhere you go. Preach Jesus at home, at school, at work, in your neighborhood, on social media. Preach Jesus in the Word. And when necessary, use words. Actions speak louder than words. And it's how we live. I'm not saying to not use words. I'm just saying the way that you and I act and what we do will say more about Jesus than what comes out of our mouth. Any final comments or questions or thoughts?
The last part of verse 8 where we were studying, read that. Well, that's part of that verse 8.
Okay, we're only up in the second verse, but the last part of the 8th verse said, now there's in store for me.
No. Talks where everybody does it, those that want to do it, something like that. I'll look it up here.
Okay.
I'll tell you. I can tell you in a minute.
Okay, I'll give you a second to look it up.
I lost it.
You lost it? Okay, maybe it'll come back to you later. I've had that happen to me before, and it's frustrating.
Oh, I'm old. You don't have an excuse.
Oh, I don't know that I'm ever without an excuse. I may not have a reason, but I've always got an excuse.
you get this old, remember some of the things I've said.
I'll do my best, Chuck. Yeah.
If he remembers.
Yeah. And if I get that old.
I said that.
And if the world hangs together that long.
Right. I just don't feel we're going to be here.
And I tell you what, the signs of the times are everywhere.
That's what scares me the most. I'm not afraid of what I'm going to have to do, but Beckett, the rest of the kids, the little ones, these three children that were just born, what are they going to have in 10 years, 15 years?
Exactly right.
If people don't wake up pretty soon, it's going to be too late.
That's right. That's right. And Jesus said, you know, when these things begin to happen, again, he's talking in Matthew chapter 24, and he talks about there's going to be wars and rumors of wars, there's going to be famines and pestilences and all sorts of things. He says, when these things begin to happen, look up, because your redemption draws nigh. He also says there in the same passage of Scripture that, you know, if you're looking and you see that the branches are starting to turn green, you know that, you know, summer is near. He says the same is true whenever you begin to see these things. It'll be like birth pangs. About Christina Dowd. You start to feel all this stuff, and you know that something's coming down the road. And what we see going on in the world right now is that there's, as far as I'm concerned, a lot of birth pangs. You found it?
Now there is in store for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his uprightness.
Yep, that's what I started to read, and you said that it wasn't right. But yeah, all of us that are faithful,
yeah,
there is going to be a great reward. The Apostle Paul was saying to Timothy, you just make sure you preach the word. So let's have a closing prayer. Father, we come together tonight to study your word, to be reminded that your word is there to give us instruction. The instruction that I hope that we heard tonight, and maybe there was other things that people picked up on that your spirit is impressing. But I know the thing that I tried to emphasize was that the Apostle Paul said there's stuff that needs to be done, which is to preach the word in season and out of season. We need to be preaching Jesus, both with our words, but also with our actions. We need to be preaching your word, the Bible, teaching other people what your word says. And then, Father, if we disobey you, we're going to suffer the consequences, and we will certainly reap your judgment. We just pray, Father, that you will help us this week as we work toward becoming the people that you've called us to be. Please continue to take care of us and our loved ones. Be with those that we prayed for earlier. And Father, guide us this week that we'll be a blessing to those we come in contact with. Have your will and your way in our lives. Use us for your glory and bring us back the next appointed time. In Jesus' name.